Κυρίες και κύριοι, αξιότιμοι και αξιότιμοι, αξιότιμες και αξιότιμοι συνάδελφοι, αγαπητές φίλες, αγαπητοί φίλοι, καλησπέρα. Σας ευχαριστούμε πολύ για την παρουσία σας απόψε εδώ. Ladies and gentlemen, honorable colleagues, dear friends, good evening. Thank you all for being here tonight. Θα ήθελα να καλωσορίσω στο Εθνικό Ίδρυμα Ερευνών τόσο εσάς, όσο και τον απόψινό διακεκριμένο ομιλητή, τον οποίο ευχαριστώ γιατί αποδέχθηκε με προθυμία την πρόσκληση που του απίθυνα προ λίγων μηνών να παρουσιάσει διαζώσεις στο Εθνικό Ίδρυμα Ερευνών και το Εθνοαθήνες Επιστημονικό Κοινό όψεις των πιο πρόσφατων μελετών του. Θα ήθελα δημοσίως να ευχαριστήσω την απερχόμενη διευθύντρια της Βρετανικής Σχολής Αθηνών, την καθηγήτρια Κάθρι Μόγκαν, η οποία όχι μόνο συμφώνησε και συνέπραξε ασμένως το να αποτελέσει η σημερινή διάλεξη συνδιοργάνωση του Ινστιτούτου Ιστορικών Ερευνών του Ιδρύματός μας και της Βρετανικής Σχολής Αθηνών, αλλά αφιέρωσε πολύτιμο χρόνο ώστε η ιδέα αυτή εν τέλει να ευοδοθεί με τη σημαντική συμβολή και του τρίτου φορέα, του Ινστιτούτου Κλασικών Σπουδών του Πανεπιστημίου του Λονδίνου, το διευθυντή του οποίου, καθηγητή Greg Wolf, ευχαριστούμε θερμά. Δράτουμε τη ευκαιρία, προκειμένου να ευχηθώ στην Κάθριν Μόγκαν καλή επιτυχία στα νέα της καθήκοντα ως Senior Research Fellow στο All Souls College του Πανεπιστημίου της Οξφόρδη, αλλά και να καλωσορίσω στην Αθήνα τον νέο διευθυντή της Βρετανικής Σχολής Αθηνών, καθηγητή John Bennett, εκφράζοντας τις ευχές όλων μας για μια γόνιμη και επιτυχή θητεία. Εάν μου επιτρέπετε ένα προσωπικό σχόλιο, συνεργασίες όπως η σημερινή μεταξύ διαφορετικών φορέων που θεραπεύουν τις κλασικές σπουδές και τη μελέτη του αρχαίου ελληνικού και ρωμαϊκού κόσμου σε εγχώρια και διεθνή κλίμακα, με άλλοτε λιγότερο και άλλοτε περισσότερο φιλόδοξους στόχους, είναι όχι μόνο ευκτές αλλά και επιβεβλημένες. Για λόγους προφανείς, εσωτερικούς προς τις επιστήμες μας, αλλά και εξωτερικούς, θα ήθελα να ελπίζω έστω και με ικανό ποσοστό ρομαντισμού συγκυριακούς. Είμαστε μάρτυρες μιας εποχής κατά την οποία αφενός μεν η ίδια η χρησιμότητα των ανθρωπιστικών σπουδών τίθεται λόγο και έργο εν αμφιβόλο, αφετέρου δε αναβιώνουν πράκτορες και κήρυκες επιθετικού σκοταδισμού και καταστροφής, όπως αυτής που αφήνει ορατές και δυστυχώς σε πλήστες περιπτώσεις ανήκε στους βλάβες, σε αρχαίους ναούς, αγάλματα, αλλά και ανθρώπους, το παρελθόν αλλά και το παρόν της Συρίας. Σε συνθήκες σαν και αυτές, η πάλη της μνήμης ενάντια στη λύση, το δικαίωμα των ανθρωπίνων κοινωνιών για τη συλλογική μνήμη και την αυτογνωσία, τα ίδια αυτά θεμελιώδη προτάγματα του ευρωπαϊκού διαφωτισμού, θα έλεγα ότι καλούν για τη μεγαλύτερη δυνατή συνέργεια και σύμπλεξη δυνάμεων επιστημονικών, ερευνητικών, ακαδημαϊκών, διανοητικών, οικονομικών. Γνωστός για την πλούσια ακαδημαϊκή, διδακτική, ερευνητική, συγγραφική και ανασκαφική του συνεισφορά και έργο, κυρίως από τις θέσεις του ως καθηγητή ελληνιστικής και ρωμαϊκής τέχνης στο Ινστιτούτο Καλών Τεχνών του Πανεπιστημίου της Νέας Υόρκης, εν συνεχεία από το 1995 έως και σήμερα ως διαδόχου του Τζον Μπόρντμαν στην έδρα της κλασικής αρχαιολογίας και τέχνης στο Πανεπιστήμιο του Λονδίνου Οξφόρδης, από τη θέση του ως διευθύνοντος επιμελητή της Cuff Gallery, του Smolian Museum της Οξφόρδης, και από το 1991 και εξής, από τη θέση του ως διευθυντή των ανασκαφών του Πανεπιστημίου της Νέας Υόρκης, στην Αφροδυσιάδα της Καρίας, υπευθύνοντας προσθέτως για τη δημοσίευση και τη μελέτη και τη δημοσίευση της γλυπτικής παραγωγής της ίδιας πόλης, ο Μπετ Σμιθ ανήκει σε εκείνους που κατά το κοινό λεγόμενο δεν χρειάζονται ιδιαίτερες συστάσεις. Παρ' όλα αυτά θα με επιτρέψετε να κάνω μερικές. Δια του θεσμικού του ρόλου έχει συμβάλει τα μάλα στη διεύρυνση και την ενίσχυση της αρχαιολογίας σε ένα κομβικό και εξέχον πανεπιστημιακό ίδρυμα, δημιουργώντας νέες θέσεις διδασκαλίας της ελληνικής και της ετρουσκικής αρχαιολογίας, εκπαιδεύοντας γενναίες προπτυχιακών φοιτητών, επιβλέποντας μεταπτυχιακές εργασίες και διδακτορικές διατριβές πληθώρας νέων ερευνητών, μεταξύ των οποίων σημαντικός αριθμός αποφύτων ελληνικών πανεπιστημίων. Ο ίδιος έχει αφιερώσει τη διδασκαλία και τις μελέτες του στις εικαστικές τέχνες, ιδιαίτερα δε στην τέχνη της γλυπτικής, στον ευρύτερο χώρο του Μεσογείου, επικεντρώνοντας τις ελληνικές πόλεις της Ρωμαϊκής Ανατολής. Ήδη από τα πρώιμα έργα του και την πρώτη του μονογραφία για τα ελληνιστικά βασιλικά πορτρέτα, έως και τις πιο πρόσφατες σημαντικές συμβολές του, όπως η μελέτη του για τα ανάγλυφα από το Σεβαστείο της Ιούλιο-Κλαουδιανής περίοδου της Αυδοδυσσιάδας, μέσα από πλήθος άρθρων, όπως τα υποδειγματικά του άρθρα για τη σημειολογία της Αττικών της Φιλοσόφων και Βασιλέων ή αυτή των τυχογραφιών της έπαυλης Μποσκορεάλε, μέσα από διδακτικά λήματα και εγχειρίδια, θεωρητικές πραγματείες, συλλογικούς τόμους και μακρόπνα συνεργατικά ερευνητικά προγράμματα, όπως αυτό για τα ύστατα αγάλματα της αρχαιότητας, ο έντυπος καρπός, ο φυσικός τόμος δηλαδή, του οποίου βρίσκεται αυτή τη στιγμή υπό έκδοση, από τη θέση του ως συγγραφέα αλλά και ως επιμελητή εκδόσεως σειρών, όπως η Oxford Monographs on Classical Archaeology, η Oxford Studies in Ancient Culture and Representation ή τη σειρά μελετημάτων και μονογραφιών για την αρχαία Αφροδυσσιάδα, Ο Μπέτ Σμιθ έχει τροφοδοτήσει με καινούριο και ομολογουμένω εντυπωσιακό υλικό, μαζί με νέα ερωτήματα και οπτικές, τη διεθνή προβληματική περί την κατανόηση του αρχαίου κόσμου, ιδιαίτερα δε περί την ερμηνευτική προσέγγιση της καλλιτεχνικής παραγωγής κατά την αρχαιότητα. Κινούμενο σε ένα εξαιρετικά ευρύ χρονολογικό φάσμα, από τους αρχαϊκούς χρόνους έως και την ύστερη αρχαιότητα, έχει καλλιεργήσει με ενάργεια το ρεύμα εκείνο της αρχαιολογίας που απέχει συνειδητά από αυτοαναφορικά και εν πολύ γραμμικά εξελικτικά μοντέλα, προτάσσοντας τη μελέτη των καταλήπων του υλικού πολιτισμού απολύτως συνταγμένων στο ιστορικό του, κοινωνικό, ιδεολογικό και πολιτικό περιβάλλον. Σκοπός του έχει υπάρξει σταθερά η διερεύνηση της ρευστής δυναμικής μιας πλειάδας σχέσεων που υπόκεινται όπως ακριβώς στο σύγχρονο κόσμο σε διαρκή αναδιαπραγμάτευση και μετασχηματισμό. Όπως η σχέση μεταξύ τεχνέργου και τόπου, τεχνέργου και χρόνου, παραγγελιοδότη και παραγγελιοδόχου, υποκειμένου και απεικόνησης, σκοπούμενου συμβολισμού και πρόσληψης, μεταξύ θρησκευτικής πολιτικής κοινότητας και ατόμου, ευεργέτη, τοπικής αρχής, μεταξύ πόλης και βασιλέα ή αυτοκράτορα, η σχέση μεταξύ τοπικού και οικουμενικού, μεταξύ μύθου και ιστορίας. Με άλλα λόγια, ο απόψινός μας προσκεκλημένος έχει επί μακρόν προαγάγει το ρεύμα εκείνο της αρχαιολογίας που θεωρεί την τέχνη και ευρύτερα τα πολιτισμικά υλικά κατάλοιπα ως προνομιακές, ισοδύναμες των γραπτών, πηγές για την ιστορική αφήγηση. Τίτλος της σημερινής ομιλίας, The Greek East under Rome, Art and Cultural Interaction. So, would you please take the floor.
Thank you very much indeed, Marina, for that very handsome introduction. It's a very great pleasure to be here in Athens and in this renowned institute. I would like to thank three people and three organizations that in difficult times have made this event possible and extended to me this very generous invitation. Firstly, Marina Kalitsi and Kara, Kathy Morgan and the BSA, British School of Athens, and Greg Wolfe, the director of the Institute of Classical Studies in London. My talk is about the character of the Roman Empire in the East, seen through its art and representations. I'm going to be talking mostly about the second century AD. I'll talk about some earlier things and some later things, but precise chronology is not really important for what I've got to say. If the Antonine period, that's the Roman Empire at its height, had a period style, it looked like the thing on the left. A highly coiffed emperor, looking like Charles II, encrusted moldings like the top right, or a deeply drilled garland sarcophagus bottom right. These things are very widespread. Was this an empire style, a Reichsstil or a Reichskultur? Looked at from a distance, from say late antiquity, the Antonine period is the time when the empire looks most global, most homogeneous, compared to its later fragmentation. Looked at from the inside, the story is different. I want to ask, in what senses is the art of the Eastern Empire Roman? Perhaps I would say only in the sense of belonging to the Roman period. I want to describe a paradox. Much of what was new in the visual and monumental culture of the Greek East was due in some way to Rome. But at the same time, little of it was intended or probably experienced by contemporaries as anything other than local or Hellenic. Cities are the context of our surviving material. In the western provinces, the cities were mostly recent foundations and followed Roman new town designs with remarkable consistency. Their temples and forum basilica complexes, some examples on the screen, expressed the aspiring Roman allegiance of the local elites, and their statues and imperial-style Latin inscriptions, bottom right, looked directly to Rome. In the Greek East, most cities had centuries of urban history behind them. They had huge reservoirs of earlier monuments, much of it of exemplary status, still in use and on display. Whatever happened in the art of the Greek cities under Rome, it was the result of choice and cultural negotiation. In broad terms, there was, of course, a slow shift towards things looking more Roman. One might say that in the first century of the empire, Greek cities maintained a broadly Hellenistic character, and in the second century came to employ more Roman imperial forms. Architectural ornament here at Baalbek, for example, can be made to tell this story. You could travel from Britain to Syria and see the same kind of encrusted entablature everywhere. The homogeneity was impressive. But we need to be ready here for the difference between what seems Roman to us and what seemed Roman at the time. The differences between an abstract essentialist description, this molding is Roman, and historical evaluation of what was marked and experienced as Roman. Moldings don't translate directly into history. All three of these entablatures might illustrate well the idea of the authority and majesty of the Roman imperial state. We might ask if they might not have meant different things in their respective cities. At the top left, from Rome, this carving enhanced the majesty of Divus Vespasianus from his temple in the forum here. We now have a chance, perhaps we didn't want the chance, to visualize Divus Vespasianus fully nude in a new statue from Misenum on the right. In Aphrodisias and Baalbek, the deities had local identities, not Greek or Roman, but respectively Anatolian at Aphrodisias and Syrian at Baalbek. On the right are two small figurines which give rough receptions of the kind of deity worshipped inside this temple. We may need to imagine that such familiar and effective carved forms were put to new local work that elided their point of origin. The increasingly Roman tenor of monuments under the empire might not be quite what it seems. A narrative of increasing Romanness is also weak if it also means decreasing Hellenism. There was much that was Roman in the cities of the early empire, just as there was much that was emphatically Hellenic later. The truth is, these cities were complex cultural entities for which simple narratives are not enough. What I want to do in this talk is to consider four zones where different subjects and functions intersect. These are my four sections, or my four realms: the realm of the emperor, the realm of the gods, the realm of the citizen, and the realm of the dead. They're useful horizontal sections through a huge quantity of material. If we ask, in what ways did Greek monuments concern themselves with Roman ideas, we'll see that the answers are not neat or predictable. The first big new phenomenon Greek cities had to deal with was the emperor, something no doubt marked as Roman to local citizens. Studies of the emperor in cult and art have, however, shown how far the emperor was remodeled. Buildings in which the emperor received divine honors, you see three here, show well the variety of local initiative. No model was available and none was imposed. The emperor and his family might have, for example, a room in a stoa, as at Kalindoia at the top. They might have a full Greek-style peripteral temple, as the temple of Domitian at Ephesus, or a frontal Roman-style podium temple, as at Aphrodisias. Roman temple designs were well understood, but even for so obviously a Roman subject, It was hardly automatic or predictable that Roman designs would be used. The emperor's portrait type, that's the emperor's head, was made available from Rome. But it was adapted and recast in local statues according to context and local preference. These local statues were named and inscribed in Greek, often with little concern for accuracy in names and titles. The Greek East is by and large uninterested in the long lists of names and titles that you find in Latin inscriptions. At Pergamum, Hadrian is just Theon Adrianon. In the overall economy of statue honors in the eastern cities, the emperor and his family were very much in the minority. I'll come back to this later. This was no 20th century style image-controlled society in which the dear leader's image was the only one on public view. After an initial variety of costume, naked, toga, cuirass, the emperor was shown from the second century, most often in the cuirass of the Roman commander, as on the left. It became his defining costume. The reformulation of the emperor's image made him as much a separate imperial figure, autocrator Caesar Sebastos, as a Roman figure. He never, of course, became explicitly Greek either. The emperor's statues never wear the Greek civilian hemation. The one example always cited in most books, the Cyrene Hadrian, has indeed a head of Hadrian, but it was put together like this either in the modern period or late antiquity. Nowhere was it thought appropriate for the emperor to cross this line and wear a Greek hemation in public in a statue. The variety of local remodeling of the emperor in busts, statues and inscriptions is impressive. But we feel it best in two great relief cycles, from Aphrodisias in the first century and Ephesus in the second. The recently restored south building of the Sebasteion looks like this. The emperors in the upper story here are restyled as supermen, as warrior heroes. I show you two. They both show Claudius. Claudius on the left, conquering Britannia, Claudius is now a new Achilles, conquering his Amazon queen, Britannia. On the right, he is a savior ruler of land and sea, striding across the universe with a kind of parachute that means epiphany. These represent imperial war on the left and imperial peace done in Hellenistic style. There was no public models in Rome for this unpredictable vision of imperial rule. The designers reformulated Hellenistic images to fit a local conception of imperial rule. Obviously, locals recognized the subjects as Roman, but their Roman identities were co-opted and reformulated by the images. Their emphasis was less Roman in our sense, more God Emperor, conceived in the explicit local formulation as Theos Sebastos Olympios, Olympian Emperor God. At Ephesus, parts of a huge frieze were found redeployed in late antiquity out of context. They came most likely from the outside of a monumental altar. This was the answer of Antonine Ephesus to the great altar at Pergamon. Interpretation as a monument to Lucius Verus and his Parthian War is without foundation. It belongs immediately after the death of Hadrian and the accession of Antoninus Pius. The dynastic configuration represented clearly here. Here's Hadrian, Pius, Marcus, and the young Lucius Verus. The date is secure independent of the monument's other iconography. And this is important and allows us to see one of its quintessential non-Roman aspects more clearly. Unlike historical monuments at Rome, the frieze is for the most part unconcerned with the appearance of truth and reality. Although Hadrian and Pius fought no great foreign wars, much of the frieze is a long and violent battle against fierce generic barbarians. It is about the higher truth that emperors keep the empire safe by constant war struggle on the frontiers. The natural language for such heroic deeds, from the perspective of Western Asia, was Hellenistic visual epic. Hadrian's empire is recast in such a militarist manner that it has been unrecognizable to some modern scholars. Where necessary, in the dynastic scene here and in the apotheosis scene here, the figures are marked as imperial by the toga or the cuirass. These are Roman costume additives needed to ensure legibility. But they are, in the entirety of the monument, few and far between. We don't know where this monument was set up in Ephesus, but you might imagine it, for example, on an altar in front of the great Olympian temple in this huge sanctuary here. One lesson from these monuments is how little Greek cities, both well-connected, Rome-oriented cities, cared about central Roman perspectives and expectations of the emperor's role. The emperor was not for them a carefully negotiated super senator with military powers, but a conquering warrior and Olympian savior. Similar radical recasting can be seen in cult portraits from Ephesus, Pergamum, and Sardis. These colossal heads, this one's 2.5 meters high, just the head, these colossal heads from acrolithic statues achieve this astonishing feat of representing the central metropolitan portrait types in a way that we can easily recognize them, even in fragments, while at the same time infusing them with a whole layer of supercharged force and vigor. It was quite alien, indeed opposed, to the intentions and purposes of the identifying types on which they are based. This is clearly based on a main portrait type of the Emperor Titus, and it comes from this temple here in the model. This is a tour de force, a dynamic Hellenistic style god, but still recognizable, easily recognizable as Titus. At Sardis, Faustina the Elder is an Olympian hero with the empress's hairstyle. This is one of the most common forms of modulation of the imperial portrait. You give the thing a classical divine face and put an imperial hairstyle on top. Pius, on the right, becomes a lean, dynamic superman with a sharp, heroic twist to his head, quite unlike his metropolitan portrait. Trust me, it really is Pius. The temple at Sardis, the plan at the top, which these heads come from, this part of the cellar, was planned in this period with a colonnade all round it, but was never actually built. This brings me to my second realm, the realm of the gods. Traditional local gods saw their temples maintained, refitted, or equipped with new colonnades and gates. These often appear on Greek provincial coins, which trumpet these structures, as at the top two slides on the left. New temples might be traditional or modern, peripteral with Roman features like a baldac. Some cities created new old temples, new old-looking temples, an interesting and I think not well understood phenomenon. Sardis, for example, took the Hellenistic cella of its temple of Artemis, this is the Hellenistic part, and in the second century made as if to build an Ionic peristasis around it. But this was never finished, deliberately or not, and it became a colossal archaic-looking ruin, like the temple of Apollo at Didyma, with columns erected only at the front and in the porches. And these were left without architraves and entablatures, and in a satisfying state of unfinish. The unfinish is very much in your face in these columns in the pronaos here. Great raw point chisel finished blocks. Whether planned or not, the Sardians clearly came to prize this great archaic temple ruinscape. It looked old and sacred, unlike the glitzy new facade architecture. Now this archaic thinking is probably expressed textually in a remarkable inscription written around the bottom of one of these columns, which is given at the top left. This is an archaic speaking monument kind of inscription. The base and the root, that's the column, the base and the column are of one stone. First of all, I arise not from public stones, but from private stones. In other words, this is a private initiative, but wrapped up in an archaic sounding speaking monument text. Note the columns have beautifully finished bases, but ostentatiously unfinished column drums. Compared to the construction cost, of course, fluting is not expensive. They've been left purposefully in the raw stone. The most extreme, the ne plus ultra example of a newly made archaic sanctuary is in the Carian Hills, south of the Meander, near the city of Alabanda, at a place called Gerga. The sanctuary spreads on terraces across this hillside, like this. You can see one of the structures here, but right across here there is a series of archaic-looking monuments. These are archaic stone huts, top right, primitive kouros-like statues, two on the bottom right, rough natural found stelae, and natural rocks, all of them inscribed in huge letters, Gergas, creating a kind of rocky, numinous landscape. They were all built in one go, not in the 6th century BC, but the 2nd century AD. This is an extreme example, a weird minority choice, but from the outer fringes of archaizing religious thought. Most gods naturally kept their classical divine portraits. The museums of Turkey and modern Greece are full of classical-looking gods made under the empire, and a great variety of technical variations. On the top left is a Hellenistic Apollo, in the middle a Roman Apollo made on the same design, and on the right a classical-looking Zeus. Only their details, their technical details, show the middle and right were made in the Roman period. Some images like this were refreshed and restyled by Antonine marble technology. For example, the statues of two river gods set up here and here in the baths of Vedius at Ephesus. The god has the hair and beard technique of a Lucius Verus bust, but remains a Greek river god. New technique makes the god alive. the technique is Roman in lots of real senses, but it has been fully internalized as simply a better technique. The dearing effects now possible can be seen in a remarkable statue of Tyche from Prusias ad Hippium. This is a 2nd century figure set alight by new techniques, textured hair, a breathing mask of divine beauty, and rustling virtuoso drapery, rather like that of Bernini's statues, as well as a radical redesign of the figure's iconography. The sculptor here has added the child, fruits, an extravagant headdress made up of a Stephanie, a mule crown, out of which grow a luxuriant growth of plants. This is the prosperous fortune of the patris of Prusias ad Hippium. We can put a statue like this in context two ways. It can be set on a long vertical axis of many other versions of the same Hellenistic Tyche figure, beside which the other versions look, well, rather dull. The Prusias statue takes the same basic composition and reworks it. We can also set the figure on a deep horizontal axis of local context. The statue was found with a base recording the dedication of an agalma to the patris of her community by a grande dame of Prusias, Calpurnia Domitia Marciana, with her 5 children and husband. Note how the layout highlights the father Julianus and Lycomedes. Here's Julianus and Lycomedes. This is a flamboyant new style agalma of and for the patris, set up by a leading family keen to show no expense was spared to honor the goddess. Julianus and Lycomedes bring us to the realm of citizens. Inside the cities, public space was reserved for the mise-en-scene of political life. Buildings and statues represent the huge importance allotted to this sphere. Much was new and Roman. Vaulted bath buildings, long basilicas, columnar facades, substructured buildings, civic complexes separated and closed in, pervasive axiality, all parts of a culture that had absorbed many of Rome's most effective architectural ideas, especially those that expressed the dignity of a city. But these ideas were easily internalized as part of an evolving Hellenistic repertoire, a common trajectory rather than a borrowing. In Greek cities under the empire, it was the role of buildings and statues to make a central paradox seem natural. Rome supported local oligarchies, and the cities were controlled by an aristocracy of landed wealth that exercised power through the offices of the council and the power of benefaction. At the same time, however, quite unlike the West, the language and ideology of political life was calibrated to that of Hellenistic democracy. The processes of demos-oriented politics were taken very seriously. Assemblies continued to meet, and their decrees and awards are decrees of the boule and the demos. A mass of inscribed public writing represents politics as though in 4th century BC Athens. The accommodation of this curious idea shaped building priorities. Long stoas defined citizen space for leisure, for strolling, for business. A newly laid out city like Aphrodisias in its city center has about 1.5 kilometers of Ionic stoa colonnade. Theaters were built everywhere. Some employed the superior semicircular Roman design, as at a spandos at the top left, and some raised the auditorium on vaulted substructures in flat ground, as for example partly at Miletus. The majority, however, continued to be built partly or mostly against a hill, and to extend in a horseshoe plan well beyond the rational semicircle. So, for example, Ephesus, or most radically, Sagalassos, where the theatre extends to an arc of 256 degrees. These were key elements of old Greek theatre design, and perhaps represented the traditional aspect of a theatre as the place of demos assembly. A key difference between Roman theatre design and Greek theatre design that was carried through the imperial period is that the Roman theatre design is closable. You can close a theatre like this and no one can get in. Greek theatre design is always open. The demos, if it wants to, can rush to the theatre as it sometimes did. In these theatres, the demos met in a neatly ordered tribal structure, which was often inscribed on the seating. Set beside their new style columnar marble skynae, these unwieldy horseshoe plans were another form of willful archaism. Stadia were an investment to attract visitors to spend money at festivals. They could also accommodate Roman games associated with the imperial cult festivals, which were clearly marked as Roman. But in contrast with the West, where arena games had their own building form, the amphitheater, Eastern cities, as a rule, chose not to build amphitheaters. Stadia marked the cultural priority of Hellenic festival games. The best citizens were members of the council, which sat in the Auditorium. These small, covered, highly designed theatres continued to be built into the imperial period, now with columnar skynae facades, as for example at Nisa, Ephesus, Stratonicea, and here at Aphrodisia. I'm showing you lots of pictures from Aphrodisia, both because I work there, but also because Aphrodisias has a lot of the very best preserved examples. The interior elaboration of these buildings represented the elevated dignity of the boule. Lavish interiors provided the setting for the speeches of the kind that we read in the collected works of Dio Chrysostom. The greatest of grandees were honored here, in statues, like this man down here. Statues, like this one, congregated at such honorific hotspots, theater and auditorium, in large numbers. This plan on the left shows you the city center of Aphrodisia, with each red dot marking the find place of a piece of honorific statuary of the Roman period. You see major concentrations in the council house and the theater. These statues honored the notables that controlled the cities and paid for the elaborately constructed urban scenery. Paying for things, embassies, festivals, buildings, and receiving honors in return were what constituted city politics under the empire. The personal statue on its inscribed base was the highest currency of this transaction. And women, and statues of women, have a surprisingly large share. I show you here a diagram which gives the relative numbers of those receiving honors in the first 2 centuries AD at Aphrodisia. It's rather surprising. Local men, women, and athletes, locals make up 74% of the total. Roman emperors and Roman central officials make up only 16%. Um, 12% for women benefactors, higher than the number of imperial figures, is, I think, surprising. Some of these women are great, wealthy landowners in their own right, and the woman we just looked at, Tatiana, Claudia Antonia Tatiana, she was so important in Aphrodisias and the province that her base doesn't even record any particular benefactions that she's given. Everyone knows why she should have a statue, which with its base is about 4.5 meters tall. Costumes. Local grandees mostly wear the himation, even when we know they're Roman citizens. They wear the himation in a variety of schemes that went back to the Hellenistic period. This costume signified Greek polis citizen of the democratic kind. The himation is the costume of the stoa, the bouleuterion, and the theatre. Some might wear it ostentatiously without the chitone beneath, like these two, in the manner of classical citizens and Hellenistic thinkers. This was now an archaism acted out in life and in statuary. The portraits adopt a wide range of cultural postures. I mention a few contrasting choices. For example, this lined, older, clean-shaven portrait style might look to us Roman. And indeed, such styles were employed in a sharpened form in the West as a marker of Roman values. However, they had also been a familiar choice in the Greek East in the first century, two examples from Kos. And the style thus came in the second century to signify rather a range of local conservative values. A wide range of portraits wore styled metropolitan hairstyles in the Antonine manner. These are hairstyles which have been artificially curled in the barber's shop. Imitating imperial portraits in this way might be seen as a gesture of affiliation, of loyalty, the so-called period face. But in another perspective, it was simply the most effective way of achieving a contemporary fashionable result. Antonine hairstyles on Greek portraits signified not a longing for Rome, but participation in the deep new culture of personal male styling. Overtly Hellenic choices were prominent in Old Greece, but are also found in Asia. They have plain, unstyled hair, thick moustaches, and beard forms derived from the 4th and 3rd centuries BC. Only their marble technique is contemporary. The meaning of this posture can be seen in such self-styled guardians of Hellenism as Herodes Atticus and the Athenian Cosmetoi, the headmasters of the Athenian gymnasium in four Herm portraits. These are images which are half Hermes, half portrait. The inscriptions on them tell us that they unite the schema of Hermes with the icon of the Cosmetes. These portraits testify again to a lived archaism. The 4th and 3rd centuries BC have been reborn in these images of Hellenic fundamentalism. This one quotes the well-known portrait of Xenophon, and this one quotes the well-known portrait of the philosopher Zenon. The portraits reach back 400 years to the golden age of Hellenic writing, thinking, and doing. Rome is here not denied, merely not a priority. My last realm, the realm of the dead. You see a tomb, a street of tombs in Hierapolis, and the city plan of Aphrodisias, with each of these squares out and triangles outside the city represents the position of a tomb or sarcophagus on the main roads in and out of town. Tombs stretched along the main roads in and out of town, an extension of the citizen realm in space and time, with many themes in common. Tomb art, however, is different in important respects. Wider social range, family orientation, sharply defined localisms, and astonishing quantity and variety. Here, many other citizens get to speak than did in the tightly constrained realm of public life inside the city. We may pick out some themes and cases. Sarcophagus burial gained momentum in the first and second centuries in unbroken continuity from Hellenistic models. The garland designs of civic and religious celebration are most common. You see here an early garland sarcophagus and a later one, first century, early third century. Rare frieze sarcophagi, like that on the right, were for grandees and represent their lives in the public realm. Here, a priestly couple pause on their way down to Hades to engage the viewer. Besides local products like these, the top end of the sarcophagus market was supplied by two great exporting centers, Athens and Dokimaeon. Roman sarcophagi from Rome were available, but were not imported. The Athenian sarcophagi were shipped all over the Mediterranean in very large numbers and were carved typically with expensive moldings and dense heroic friezes formatted in compact walls of high relief figures fitted to the dimensions of each sarcophagus chest. The old stories, here the battle of the ships, are relived as representations of aspirational virtue. The grandest Dokimaeon sarcophagi had columned chests, elaborately carved with idicular architecture, framing tall, mannered statue figures of the owner, his entourage, and his ideal family. Here, wives, daughters, thinker writers, citizen orators, children, and officiating priests and priestesses are present, as though on honorific parade in columned public architecture. Hunting, religious observance, paideia, and festival culture are other themes. Here's a scene of sacrifice at a small altar. Hunting, more hunting, and festival culture in a small frieze that ran around the other side of this sarcophagus. It's a representation of a set of athletic games. Sarcophagi like this were exported at huge expense, mainly to cities in Asia, from Nicaea to Antioch, with surviving concentrations, for example, at Perge and Iconion, that's Konya. Their inscriptions show that these were for the very top of the landed provincial elite, often senatorial families. Some of these things are of vast size. This one here, the famous Sidamara sarcophagus now in Istanbul, is in fact the largest surviving sarcophagus from the ancient world. I show you a picture now with someone standing beside it. You can see the size. For those of you who know England well, it's about the size of a transit van. Some tombs made a more explicit negotiation of their owners' Greek-Roman identities. The tomb library, built for Julius Celsus at Ephesus around AD 110 to 120, represented him in both Greek and Latin texts and in various roles, including one here as a Roman commander. The statues of his Hellenic virtues, the statues of Celsus were positioned up here, and the personifications of four of his virtues were in the lower story. And they are framed by rather remarkable scroll work around the door frames. Here are the statues, Sophia, Arete, Epistene, and Enoia of Celsus. And these are the scroll work door frames, which have worked into them representations of the Roman fasces. Note with the axes exposed, meaning the power of the Roman magistrate outside the city of Rome. This is a rather remarkable and thoughtful combination of Greek-Roman aspects that this person had in his curriculum vitae. The building, in fact, counts up across the doors 12 fasces representing Celsus's consular rank. The contemporary monument in Athens for Gaius Julius Antiochus Epiphanes Philopappos, who died in 116, the grandson of the last king of Commagene, went further. The monument's images and inscriptions bring out with thought and care the three main aspects of his multiple identity. First, as Syrian royalty, secondly, as an Athenian office holder, and thirdly, as a Roman consular. The statues of Seleucus Nicator was here, and his grandfather, Antiochus IV, on the left, addressed his royal connections. Philopappus' own statue in the center, you see it better in a drawing here, wore a hamation and sandals that represented his Hellenic Athenian identity. Below, the magnificent frieze describes his role as a Roman consul, accompanied by lictors. The bilingual inscriptions, which were inscribed on these pilasters here and here, list his, on one, his Roman curriculum vitae in Latin, and his royal and Athenian offices in Greek on the other. The subject of each inscription is suited to the language used and to a presumed audience. These two unusual monuments at Ephesus and Athens, monuments of Celsus and Philopappus, were from the apex of provincial society, where the relationship of Hellenic culture and Roman power was negotiated ostentatiously. They are, of course, the minority. At other social levels, no one gave a fig for, no one cared very much about such negotiations. Three discrete brands of tomb art can illustrate intense localism, monuments for a local audience only. First, on the left, we see a family of prosperous Phrygian farmers with unclassical renderings of self and family, but labeled in Greek. Top right, we see a young woman at Egyptian Thebes, in a mummy with blushing portrait, and bottom right, a turbaned and bejeweled Palmyrian woman. The Phrygian on the left, Lycuskos, cares something about Greek citizen norms, but the Theban and Palmyrian women couldn't care less. They make their own choices from a position of knowledge. I come back to my four realms and to conclude. The Greek East was permeated by good Roman ideas and technologies, but mostly they were not marked as Roman and were put to work for local purposes and acquired local and Hellenic meaning. The representation of the emperor, the most obviously Roman zone, was among the most vigorously reconfigured. The emperor was recast in Hellenistic ways that turned him into something local and familiar. The old gods could be reinvigorated with Antonine marble techniques pioneered in Rome, but without, of course, compromising their identities in any way. The citizen realm, for all its Roman technique, was intensely Hellenic in posture. The world of the Stoa and the Hamation, both long-standing representations of demos-oriented political culture. There were some clear imported Roman ideas, such as older Trajanic-looking portraits, like this guy here, Trajanic-looking portraits, and heavily carved idicular architecture. These turned out, in their local context, to be little concerned with Romanness. Roman citizenship or membership of the Senate was worth declaring as telling additions in inscribed texts, but were not a priority in statues. The realm of the dead supported the widest range of multiple identities. Roman citizenship, however, was rarely chosen as a valued and effective theme. On elite sarcophagi, the emphasis was primarily on family, education, and religious piety. What I want to emphasize is that these were all matters of choice. None was the result of imperial instruction or any grand imperatives of cultural development that led inexorably to what we have before us. They could all at any point have been different. The cities might have chosen to represent their participation in the Roman Empire through amphitheaters in every city, through many more imperial monuments, through the regular wearing of the toga in art and life by all those who had the Roman citizenship, through more bilingual Greek and Latin inscriptions, through consistently Roman-style podium temples reserved for the worship of the imperial family, through the conversion of agoras into forum basilica complexes. Such things would have been perfectly explicable, and we might even have said they were predictable. And they would, of course, have told us huge amounts about the character of the Roman Empire. But none of these things happened, or at least not at all regularly. Such choices were made, they were possible, but they're a small minority. And I show you some of those minority choices on the screen now. A huge amphitheater at Pergamum, extremely rare. The wearing of the toga, quite common for young men who had no other things to boast of if they were citizens, but not at all common in the cities of Asia. Latin, extremely rare. Imperial monuments, apart from busts and statues, also extremely rare. Other choices were made based on deep premises. The Roman state controlled the political trajectory of the Greek cities, but had no interest in imposing cultural values. The city elites embraced the empire and the position of local power it gave them, and added a few elements of explicit Roman color to their main preference for a Hellenic cultural posture of some four centuries earlier. These choices, however, were now enacted on a scale, in a quantity, and with the technology that were made possible by Roman circumstances. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it was a very great chance about a month ago that two emails arrived on my desk on the same day. One from Mirina saying we must find a way to get Bert Smith to Athens to give a lecture, and the other from Greg Wolfe in London saying could we perhaps think of a way of sending a British academic to Greece in an exchange relationship with the Greek lectures we do in London. Something was clearly meant to be, and I'm very grateful to Bert for such a deceptively simple lecture that drew on material that was so familiar and yet so unfamiliar at the same time, and which brought a set of ideas that had me thinking all the way through. If I was Roman, would I be more afraid of Greeks bearing gifts or Greeks receiving gifts? If I was Greek, would I be thinking, this is globalization, I like it? And from a modern perspective, walking from Britain to Syria in a familiar route, that was extraordinarily rich and very thought-provoking, and I'm very grateful to him for agreeing to take some questions. So may I perhaps open the floor now? For those of you familiar with this amphitheatre, you know that there are actually microphones by your seat, our little ones, but there's also a roving microphone in the back. So who would like to begin with questions? Digging into the questions, multiple questions of agency that you raised. And how you talked about decisions, but how this is actually operating within these communities. Is it really very, very local? Or how much interchange is there? And why suddenly would a woman accept an honorific statue in one way but perhaps be buried in another? How's that work?
Yeah, the agency is of course a difficult issue. My perspective is, I've come at this from thinking about the very rich archaeology of Aphrodisias, which is in many ways typical, in other ways untypical. But it seems that the reach there of the Roman state, and I'm sure it's not unusual for many other places like it, the desire of the Roman state to get anything done in places like that, beyond having them behave themselves and if need be, pay taxes, was minimal. There's very little, as far as one can see, imperial initiatives, whether in building statues that would have an effect in the material culture we have. Of course, they received a lot of letters and things, but they were usually letters and edicts which came to them in response to something they'd ask. There's very little in the way of, as far as I can see, a desire to make a difference in cultural terms that would have any material correlates that we can get hold of. On the women, I mean, yeah, the women are extraordinary. Of course, they can't participate in the council, they can't attend the theatre and the organs of government, but those were less important in a way than the astonishing public prominence afforded to benefactors and priestesses in the ritual life of the city, in terms of processions and games, putting on shows, for which they receive this remarkably high proportion of statues. You mean specifically at Gerga? I wish we had more examples of Gerga, but they were right out on the end of the branch, if you see what I mean. Gerga is, as far as we know, a unique attempt by some local community to create a totally artificial but convincing-looking, rustic, archaic shrine. They know about kuroi, roughly speaking. They know about small temple-like shrines, but there are no precise models they're drawing on. They're not looking at particular archaic structures or images. They're going much further than that. They're in fact recreating an archaic style of monuments that never really existed, even in the archaic period. Normally the archaism, the more wider based archaism, I would say, is in temple design and in images of gods, which have usually an older style that represents the majesty and authority of the past, drawing on usually classical figures, not usually archaic figures.
Thank you very much for that very rich lecture, and in saying that, I just echo what Kathy has said. I wonder if I could push you a little bit about the theaters, because I was quite struck with your emphasis on how some of them are Roman and some of them are Greek in design, your linking of the theater with the council, and your emphasis that, unlike at Pergamon, many, many of these cities don't have amphitheaters, that that's something that happens elsewhere, as at Aphrodisias in the stadium. But what happens with theaters like Miletus, where the theater is at some point renovated, apparently, so it can have animal games safely? Then what happens?
Sure, a lot of Greek theaters are adapted, especially in the second century, to take beast hunts and gladiatorial fighting. It's all the more astonishing that, given, as has long been known, the Greek cities loved these shows, but they never went for, or very rarely went for, purpose-built structures for them. I guess it's partly because these games were so expensive to put on. They're actually quite rare in the calendar, once a year probably at the most. But I think they're not something particularly perceived of as Roman and alien. They're connected to the imperial cult, but they don't use, I think, Roman names for gladiators. They don't call them transliterated Munera or Venationes. They call them Monomachia and Cunegesia. The theatres with Roman form, like Miletus and Aspendos, are a tiny minority. The vast majority use the horseshoe form, which is intensely impractical. It's much easier to design a theater on 180 degrees and creates all kinds of difficulties in their construction, especially if you're building it against a theater hill like they want to do for economic reasons. If you're building it against a hill, it's much better if it doesn't come all the way around, and you have to build up the outer edges. There's something about that plan that, against all the odds, they're just damn well going to have. And I think it's because it carries this weight of authority and tradition and the association of what theatres are for in the Greek East. And I didn't go into it in much detail, but I do think the aspect of access and closability is vital. It's something built into Roman theatre design from the beginning. Romans having this near panic fear of theatres and the trouble they cause when the rabble gets in there are closable entities, and it's equally vitally important from a Greek political ideological perspective that they be open. And that probably also is part of this horseshoe-shaped plan that they stick to.
Right. I was thinking in part that if you have this theatre that is then adapted for what we would call Roman-style games, that there then come points where you're using it for other things, but that adaption still stays there. So presumably the demos is meeting in these theaters, and so then what happens to the way you experience that space, which has then been adapted for something that has an aspect of being more Roman than the demos perhaps meeting in a theater? Do you see where I'm going on that?
Yeah, I don't think the demos would be worried about it. The primary reason for having bruteria and theaters, the primary function of both of those, I would say, is driven by the need to prioritize on the cityscape the council and the demos. They represent those two things. And the primary function of the theater is as a place for the demos to meet. The demos doesn't meet all the time. It's a wonderful building. You can use it for all kinds of other entertainment and event. We get terribly excited about gladiatorial games and beast hunts. We kind of separate them off, but they're merely part of a wide spectrum of activities. And I don't think they would feel any incongruity or trouble about going into a theater where they'd had gladiators the week before.
There is a passage where he just thinks that they contaminate the pure essence of Hellenism. Mm-hmm. And the question I would like to ask is whether, during the second sophistic, in quotation marks, resistance against the Roman rule is by, as you say, ignoring, going back to a frozen time of, in quotation mark, pure Greekness. Mm-hmm. Your lecture made me think that by, for instance, this archaizing element is part of a second sophistic return to fictive genealogies, to a past that does not exist and is a silent, way to ignore the Roman rule, not by fighting against it, but by a certain Greek nostalgia and idealization of the past, okay? And I think this has been studied a lot by Simon Swain and other scholars.
True. Yes, I would agree with most of that, except the word opposition. And I'm sure there were lots of people who hated the Romans. Absolutely, but we don't have their voices, and we certainly don't have any correlates in the archaeology of opposition. The people might have looked at these monuments like, you know, the Antonine altar at Ephesus or the Sebastian at Aphrodisias and said, oh my God, that's awful. They might... Right. Resistance among the Greek elite, despite generations of people looking for it, is extremely hard to find, even in highly articulate, sophisticated texts. We're certainly not going to find oppositional images, monuments in the archaeological record. It's not really within the potentialities of surviving monuments to express that kind of thing, I would say. That I'm happy with.
Otherwise, the phrase "that I'm happy with" sounds like a very good moment to thank our speaker again and just to invite everyone to join us.